Well, I think Nine Inch Nails have the potential to be one of the biggest rock acts in the world. And they have a live show which is second to none.
I mean, the whole idea of playing outside for us is a real foreign idea because we're a definite inside, controlled environment, dark kind of band. I wouldn't say there's a typical Nine Inch Nail type band. I mean, if there is, I'm not really aware of it. I mean, there's a general dress, usually not a lot of pink and lace and that sort of thing. But we just weren't interested in making another typical looking video, you know, so. With the limited resources we had, we tried to, you know, do what we could.
Over here, the term industrial is kind of slapped on anything that's synth or drum machine oriented that's not a house track. And it's just more aggressive type stuff. Skinny Puppy, Ministry are like the leaders over here. And there's definite tip of the hat to that, to those bands. I have respect for them and like them. Trying to kind of bastardize that genre a bit, bringing in some other elements that you normally don't see that much. I've never had anything remotely traumatic like that happen, or my generation as a whole. You know, it's been television, sit back, relax, enjoy life, you know, and get bored, essentially. And I think maybe, stretching this a bit, that may tie into just the disgust and that kind of fuels some of this music. It's kind of technological, rebellious, you know, using the technology today, but in a bad way. Ow!
A year after a film murder scene landed in a cornfield hundreds of miles from Chicago, police and FBI narrowed the case down to the victim's identity. They can be excused for wishing they'd never found him.
It was a mystery that could have come from the mind of David Lynch, only it wasn't a fictional Twin Peaks or a twisted blue velvet imitation of small-town America. This one was for real.
The abridged actual truth story, a bit distorted by hard copy if you've seen that classic piece of film work, is we were doing a video for First Single Down in it quite a while ago in Chicago. One of the scenes was I'm laying on the ground, and we had cameras, Super 8 cameras with weather balloons hooked up to them with helium. Start the camera, let the balloon go, and they had a string, we could pull it back down. And then when we do the footage backwards, it looks like the camera drops onto my head. But the first time we did it, the balloon, the ropes broke and the balloon flew off into nowhere.
Michigan.
We didn't know that at the time. And about a year, 18 months later, we got a call from the FBI saying that someone had found this footage, thought it was some sort of murder, snuff film type clue. Sent it to the FBI. The FBI tracked down a bunch, realized it was from Chicago. And somehow made the connection to the people that did our video and realized it was just a video. So.
A cluster of weather balloons had carried the Super 8 movie camera more than 100 miles from downtown Chicago across the Great Lakes to a farmer's field outside of Burr Oak, Michigan. The camera contained film that seemed to have recorded a killing, a cult-like murder with a body surrounded by weird-looking men in strange outfits. The Michigan State Police, the Chicago Police, the FBI spent more than a year investigating the case, trying to determine who the victim was and what had happened to him. They even sent out flyers to area schools in hope of generating leads. Then one day they got a tip that blew the case wide open. The tip came from an art student in Chicago who had spotted something on television that reminded him of a police flyer he had seen. Now I'm not sure who this art student was or what he was doing at the magical moment, but I imagine it must have been something like this. He must have been at his easel. There must have been a model. And apparently the television was going at full blast at the same time. Something caught the attention of the art student, and it wasn't the woman he had been painting. It was the image on the television screen, the same footage that had baffled lawmen across the nation. After the police got the art student's tip, they were shocked to learn that the weird images on the film had nothing to do with a gang killing or a satanic ritual, but with something many people feel is just as insidious. The film that was found in the cornfield was meant for an underground rock video starring Trent Reznor. This is Trent Reznor, a man with a flair for wearing jewelry in his nose and a total disregard for what police have to go through every day of their lives. You see, Trent Reznor is very much alive.
I don't know, 6 months ago, we got a call from, my manager called me up and said, you won't believe what just happened. Got a call from an investigator in Chicago that thinks that I might be dead. So there was talk of me having to go to Chicago to prove that I'm alive, but I never had to do that, so I think they feel a little bit silly, which is good.
After police discovered Reznor to be the body they had been looking for, everything else fell into place. The men around his body were members of his band. The strange jackets were from the costume department. The deathly pallor on Reznor's face was the result of cornstarch. And the camera attached to the balloons was the low-budget equivalent of a Hollywood crane shot. Only this one got away.
Our top government agency, the Federal Bureau of Intelligence,
couldn't crack the Super 8 film.
It couldn't crack the Super 8 code.
When the Chicago police was approached about the case, they didn't have anything to say about it. And when we found Trent Reznor on the road before a concert, he didn't have any regrets about the wasted year of police work that could have gone into solving some real crimes. In fact, he found it all amusing.
When the news came through that, yeah, this was some sort of cult killing, I'd been killed, this great story. Initial reaction was it was really funny. You know, something could be that blown out of proportion and this many people worked up about it. And I felt kind of good that the police had made idiots of themselves, you know.
Did he say idiots? Don't tell that to retired cop Paul Wood. He's just glad that there's one less murder victim to mourn and one less crime to solve.
If anything, it didn't look to me like a production film, and it looked like a homemade type something, or a kid's playing a prank and see what happened. So several people here looked at it, and we still weren't 100% sure. That's why we, you know, I thought it was our duty to one way or the other turn on that film.
Paul Wood doesn't wear rings in his nose. He's just a 51-year-old ex-cop who's done everything he could to protect people from the worst things in life, and who had spent the past year working a case that's just a joke to Trent Reznor and his producers. But unlike Reznor, who has no soft spot for cops, Paul Wood has a soft spot for kids and their crazy fads. And despite everything that's happened, he even has a soft spot for rock videos.
In general, you know, it don't bother me. The ones I'm concerned about are the ones that show violence. And I think, you know, the young people that are watching them can be impressionable and, you know, and be desensitized by what they're watching. That's like, in this society, it seems like life is cheap.
Strange. In fact, some truths are weirder than fiction, aren't they?
Some rock singers are, too.